Hello, my name is Paul Jenkins, Managing Director of UK Packaging Innovation Consultancy, The Pack Up. Welcome to our latest webinar, Plastic Packaging Innovations, Volume 2. So what are we going to cover off in the next hour or so? First of all, we'll give you a little bit of introduction about the Pack Up and what our Innovation Zone platform is. We'll then crack on and talk about some plastic packaging innovations, Volume 2, Part 1. So we've got about 10 innovations that we'll discuss from our Innovation Zone platform. Then delighted that David Rimmer, Managing Director at Unette Group, will be doing his presentation about reducing plastic waste through innovative packaging solutions. So very much looking forward to that. We'll then dip back straight back into Plastic Packaging Innovations Volume 2, Part 2, with some more interesting and exciting initiatives from our Innovation Zone platform. Section at the end will be for questions and answers. So as always, there's a Q&A box in the Zoom dialogue section. So to make sure you get your questions in there, and we'll do our very best to answer them at the end. And then we'll finish with details of our next event. Please get your questions in. You will be emailed a link to this webinar tomorrow. So you better watch it in its entirety again, should you wish, or maybe share with a colleague or two. And all our content is available on youtube.com/thepackup. So without further ado, what is The Pack Up and who are we? So we're a leading packaging innovation consultancy. So working with brand owners, retailers and packaging suppliers from around the world, really. So we offer packaging project management and support. We do in-person and online events. We publish packaging reports, our most recent one being the Refillable and Reusable Packaging Compendium. And last but not least is our Innovation Zone platform. We have collated nearly 7,000 packaging initiatives from the last few years into a searchable and easy to use innovation platform. We upload 5 new initiatives every day, so 25 a week. And these are from sort of in market launches back to sort of concepts and in development. Initiative. So very much a view of what's out there and what may be coming down the line. So very much a global view. So we're tracking initiatives from all around the world, and a really good way to keep you and your packaging teams up to speed, keep inspired and come up with those next best brilliant ideas. So without further ado, let's look at some plastic packaging innovations you need to know, part one. Cubic is a new packaging design from Norway incorporating a space-saving and sustainable pack shape. The unique cup form is adaptable to various types of produce and can significantly reduce costs and emissions associated with transport, logistics, storage and cooling. Cubic has recently delivered salad trays to a North American company, enabling them to double the amount of lettuce transported on a pallet, significantly reducing packaging and costs. The pyramid-shaped square cups with 6 cups form cubes with only 8% air, so therefore utilize volume as efficiently as possible. Cubic has also been in dialogue with major players in the grocery industry in Norway, including Barmer, who initially purchased 200,000 cups for packaging blueberries. In a consumer test carried out with Dole, Cubic outperformed existing packaging solutions. When stacked as cubes, the pyramid-shaped cups distribute forces evenly in all directions, allowing the packaging to withstand more impact and pressure than traditional packaging. Cubic is an alternative solution that is set to reduce costs and emissions and improve the efficiency of packaging and transportation. California-based Preferred Packaging has joined forces with Norwest Frozen to launch a line of extended shelf life refrigerated prepared meals. Together, the companies have developed a high barrier lidding film that delivers hermetically sealed meals with a specific low oxygen atmosphere inside the package to help keep the food fresh. The new meals include a frozen croissant shaped gnocchi pasta product called Crocci. The pasta is cryo frozen and packaged in a high barrier modified atmosphere containers. The companies jointly developed the new lidding film so that the trays could be sealed on high speed machines efficiently to CPET, crystallized polyester, trays, and through contaminants such as sauces. Preferred Packaging said that the customers can peel back the lidding material off the tray, removing the need for a knife or scissors. The lidding films can also be used for fresh, all-natural foods that are packaged and then processed with high-pressure pasteurization. Next up is Dutch packaging manufacturer Porhus Packaging, and they're offering what they claim is the lightest polypropylene packaging in Europe. The new trays, jars, and lids are aimed at the fresh fruit and vegetable market. And to highlight this, they recently presented the lightweight packs at Fruit Logistica in Berlin last month. They are available as a monomaterial and are 100% recyclable. As well as the lightweight polypropylene products, Porhus presents a complete series of rPET, recycled PET, sealed jars and trays. Manufacturing is increasingly using recycled materials, so their new material called Tray to Tray is available in ever-increasing quantities so that it can be used more widely. In addition to the aforementioned plastic solutions, Porhus has also been offering a series of cardboard packaging, including a jar and its lid that can be printed in four colours. UK supermarket Sainsbury's has announced it is removing traditional plastic tray packaging across its entire beef mince range and replacing it with a vacuum packed alternative. The supermarket says that the move will result in a reduction of over 55% of plastic per pack, which equates to a saving of 450 tons of plastic per annum. The minced beef products will be vacuum packed for freshness by removing all oxygen, which typically causes the product to eventually spoil. The new packaging will contain the same amount of beef mince, but is smaller in size, helping customers to use their freezer and fridge space more efficiently by taking up less space, obviously. The change will be across all Sainsbury's beef mince products, currently retailing for just under £2 for 500 grams. The new beef mince is in a revamped packaging, is now available both in-store and online. And I picked up a newspaper for the first time in many months at the weekend and noticed they were actually doing double page spreads promoting this change, with the tagline of it not looking very pretty, but being very effective and very much focusing on the fact that they reduced the amount of plastic that they have. Next up is an innovation we've actually tracked before called Difold, but they're making good progress with a partnership with a company called DSM Engineering Materials. They're based in Troy, and they've partnered with Difold, which is a sustainability startup, develop foldable and reusable products. Difold has chosen to use DSM Engineering Materials Arnotel Eco, a bio-based thermoplastic copolyester, to produce its origami foldable water bottle. This aligns with Difold's objective to reduce the environmental impact of the packaging waste. The patented design of the origami bottle, inspired by the Japanese art of paper folding, can collapse to less than 10% of its original volume, making it convenient for users and reducing its carbon footprint during shipping. And certainly anyone that carries a reusable bottle, this is an absolute godsend to actually reduce the pack size, effectively decimated to 10%. Arnotel Eco is partially derived from renewable rapeseed oil, resulting in a 50% reduction in carbon footprint compared to traditional copolyesters. The material can also be recycled and has the required mechanical properties for the folding design. Additionally, it is BPA free and can withstand temperatures ranging from minus 30 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius without any loss of quality in the recovered material. India-based Topham Specialty Films and UK-based Polymateria have announced a breakthrough in sustainable plastics by developing packaging which fully biodegrades, leaving no microplastic or toxins behind, apparently. Data released shows that biotransformed packaging, as they call it, can return to nature in a record time, a declared and very specific 176 days. The so-called revolutionary technology reportedly does not affect the mechanical or aesthetic qualities and allows the plastic to be recycled for a predetermined time via a time set feature. It is claimed to be the fastest ever full biodegradation of BOPP, biaxially orientated polypropylene, which is used in lots of food and cosmetic packaging. The result has achieved using Polymateria's innovative biotransformation technology, which they claim is set to play a significant part in reducing plastic pollution. Products using the technology can be recycled, but if they escape into nature, they will biotransform into a bioavailable wax. The wax then attracts microorganisms like bacteria and fungi, which safely digest it and return it to nature without harm. Nestlé Portugal has announced that its Nestlé coffee packaging for professionals, for restaurants and cafes, therefore, is now easier to recycle. The aluminium layer in the previous bag's makeup has now been removed, making it a monomaterial. And we're seeing lots of this activity in the market, the removing of complex materials to make a package mono material, particularly aluminium. Nestlé says that the safety and quality of the coffee is unaffected by the changes you would expect. And this move to a monomaterial means that after use, the empty packs can now be recycled in Portugal's yellow recycling bins. The artwork has been simplified with a predominantly white palette, which the company says makes it easier to read. Nestlé has made the commitment that by 2025, more than 95% of packaging will be reusable or recyclable, aware that the focus will always be on achieving 100%. Through this commitment, the company is making its contribution to the Portuguese Pact for Plastics, which it is a founding member. AMSTI, also known as America's Styrenics, is a North American polystyrene manufacturer specializing in circular recycling. They are now collaborating with Pactive Evergreen, the leading fresh food and beverage packaging manufacturer in North America. Based on a mass balance approach, certain Pactive Evergreen packaging will use AMSTI's ISCC Plus certified recycled polystyrene. ISCC Plus is an internationally recognized certification process for circular content, and we often make reference to this in our innovation zone, which audits the supply chain from end to end. Together, the companies will develop innovative foam polystyrene packaging products. A spokesperson for AMSTI said that its lightweight and performance qualities make foam polystyrene a desirable material. And with the addition of circular content through advanced recycling, it makes even more sense. Pactive Evergreen will begin offering its customers the ability to purchase this certified polystyrene packaging in the first half of this year. A multi-company collaboration has resulted in a recyclable polyethylene stand-up pouch with high barrier properties. Five companies involved are petrochemical giant ExxonMobil, adhesive manufacturer Henkel, film specialist Krauss Foley, ink supplier Siegwerk, and printing press manufacturers Windmüller and Hulster. After use, the new pouch can reportedly produce an almost colorless recyclate. This has been achieved by applying Siegwerk's delamination de-inking primer technology. The pack's oxygen barrier properties are credited to Henkel's one component barrier coating, Loctite Lyofol BC 1582RE, a real mouthful, as well as Siegwerk's CirqKit Oxbar BX 1582. The MDOPE films are in turn a joint development between ExxonMobil and Krauss Foley, produced on the Varex 2 extrusion line with inline MDO units using ExxonMobil's HDPE and enabling performance PE. Cyclos HDP has also confirmed the pouch is recyclable, and Seawork also states colored and white inks by them meets the critical guidance by the Association of Plastic Recyclers, APR. that's the end of part one of our talk of the latest plastic packaging innovations. I'm now delighted to introduce you to David Rimmer, MD at Unette Group. David has a wealth of experience in the packaging industry and has been MD of Unette for nearly 8 years. Unette offer a range of premium sachets and tear-top tubes for the packaging of nutraceuticals, food, sports gels, and collagen drinks for people on the go. David will be discussing how you can reduce plastic waste through innovative packaging. We will have a Q&A session at the end of the webinar, so get your questions in. David, over to you.
Yes, thank you for your introduction, Paul. I'm delighted to be able to share with you a few ideas for reducing plastic that you probably haven't come across before. Today, we're going to show brand holders how they can reduce plastic waste by up to 80% and cost by up to 25%. We're going to show them how to take a major step forward in hitting your corporate responsibility targets and also to bring their brand to a new generation of consumers. In particular, we're going to take a look at some solutions that could reduce, refill, rethink our plastic packaging. So, who are we? Who is Unette? We are first and foremost specialist contract packers. We pack liquids, pastes, and gels for nutraceutical, nutrition, cosmetics, industrial, and automotive markets, pretty much anything. We've been around for over 60 years and we're based in Nantwich, Cheshire. That's near Manchester in the UK. And the thing that sets us apart is that we build all our own machines. So we have a range of unique formats not available anywhere else. So let's bring to life what we do. So we work with brand holders who want premium sachet solutions. We take an IBC of the customer's product, we get the design printed, we form the tubes or sachets, we call them, on our machine, we fill the product into our tubes, and then we pack them into whatever format the customer wants. And we do all this in our purpose-built ISO 9001 BRC AA facility, and it's powered by our solar panel installation, which we installed last year. So that's who we are and what we do. Let's talk about the problem that we're all trying to solve. And that's plastic pollution. It's a massive problem. It's a problem for wildlife and ocean creatures. Much of the UK's plastic waste is dumped and burned overseas, affecting people's health. To stop this, we must produce less plastic in the first place. We have a responsibility to the world, the country, and future generations. It can no longer be ignored, and brands and corporate organizations are under increasing scrutiny as to what they are doing to help this situation. Let's just take a bit more of a look at corporate responsibility. So brand holders and companies can't swerve this issue any longer. Customers demand it, employees demand it, partners and vendors demand it, investors demand it. And just a few stats for you, 90% of large US companies publish sustainability and responsibility reports. I suppose it makes you wonder, how long will the other 10% actually stay in business who are not taking sustainability seriously? The push for sustainability and responsibility is a reaction to growing stakeholder expectations. And 73% of investors are looking for environmental and social responsibility sustainable in business. So declaring their environment, their economic, and their social policies. Now, let's have a think about the role of sustainability and looking forward, and in particular, the role of Gen Z, Gen Z, and sustainability. So who are they and why are they so important? Well, Gen Z are people born between the 90s and the noughties, roughly spanning 1995 to 2010. Here is some data from the World Economic Forum. From the graph, you will see that the declining importance of brands when consumers are making their purchases, sustainability is far more important in fact. It goes on to say that 3/4 of Gen Z buyers prefer to buy sustainably rather than go for the brand name. The days of hero brands are over, unless they become sustainability heroes themselves. Worse to come for brands that are not making step changes in their sustainability choices is that Gen Z are not only the purchasers of the now and the future, they're going to be running our companies in the next few short years. So what are brand holders actually doing? Well, recently I attended the Paris Packaging Show, and it was billed as the cosmetic packaging of the future. What I saw was a range of screw cap tubes made from 100% mono PP, 50% post-consumer recycled polyethylene, bio-based polyethylene or sugar cane, and then some lightweighting up to 28% in sleeve and cap and head. But that was it. Commendable efforts, but as we know, invariably the packaging is contaminated. So only a small percentage will actually get recycled. According to Greenpeace, less than 10% of our plastic packaging waste is recycled in the UK. And even then, considering the considerable conversion costs and significant transportation and reprocessing costs, isn't it simpler to just use less plastic in the first place? And this has been the approach for us at Unette. And I'm not talking about small changes in plastic reduction. We're talking about big ones, up to 80%. Now, I'm not here to judge brand holders' efforts. As we've heard, the consumers will decide that. I just want to show you what is possible, and the rest is up to you. So I now want to introduce you to Econet. Now, we're introducing Econet as a sub-brand to offer a range of plastic reduction solutions to brand holders that wouldn't normally find us. We are a contract packer at the end of the day, so why would anyone think to look there for plastic reduction solutions? But with the power of the right SEOs, we hope to become visible to a whole new audience of brand holders that want to make a big difference to their business and to the planet. The three fundamental principles in our offering are reduce, refill, and rethink. So, part of our reduce offering is our unique flagship solution, the Tear and Tuck Reclosable Sachet. It uses 80% less plastic than the equivalent screw cap tube. So let's take a look at our promotional video. So there we have it. This is the tear and tuck. And so we wanted to test the concept, and we worked with Eureka Europe. And consumers were showed two products side by side, both 50 mil tubes, and were presented with a number of statements. And the less plastic reclosable sunscreen pack and the eco-responsible reclosable sunscreen pack scored 7.8 out of 10. Now, what they measure this on is the consumer's feedback is interpreted on whether the product was meaningfully unique and their likelihood to buy. Now, Eureka Europe said that score of 7 or more and you have a winner on your hands. So 7.8 out of 10 is a great score, and it was particularly popular with younger buyers. But the benefits of tear and tuck don't stop there. Here's some more methods of reduction, and this time it's in place of carbon emissions. So the product can be helped. Here is a pallet of screw cap tubes, 5,000 of them. Sat alongside is a roll of laminate, which can also produce 5,000 tear and tuck tubes. The comparison is stunning. Less space, less pallets, less transport equals lower carbon emissions. So let's hear what our very own Gen Z Ella has to say about tear and tuck, and she has a live demonstration for you.
Hi everyone, my name's Ella and I'm part of the sales team here at Unette, and I'm here just to briefly talk about our tear and tuck reclosable sachet. The whole concept behind the sachet is that it's lightweight, it's durable, you can dispense as little or as much product as you'd like and reclose it and use it at a later date, but also it can be up to 80% less plastic than your typical screw cap tube. I'm just going to briefly do a quick demonstration on how we use it. It's really quick and easy. So you simply just tear off the tip here, so you tear that off. You can dispense as little or as much product as you'd like. You then simply just get rid of the excess product in the nozzle, and then you can fold it and close it like that. Now, as you can see, I'm putting a lot of pressure onto this sachet and no product is coming out of it. This then means that you can put it in your back pocket, you can put it in your bag, on the go, and no more product is going to come out of it. I don't know about anybody else, but when you travel and you have your clear plastic bags, I struggle to fit a lot of stuff in there. With this, you can fit as many of these in. And I think the most important part is that it is up to 80% less plastic than a typical screw cap tube.
So there we have it. Let's move to another of our reduce plans. So the next product I have to show you is our child resistant. We built our business on the easy opening of our tear top tubes, but here is a solution that requires a pair of scissors to open. The tube has been tested to BS ISO 14735 and US 16 CFR 17020. And here we have it shown as a replacement for rigid plastic bottle used for nick shots in the vape industry. If you look closely at the scales, you will see that the rigid plastic bottle weighs 8.2 grams. And the child resistant pack weighs 1.2 grams. That's a massive 85% reduction in plastic. Our next solution is a little more common, and that is the refill. This is our version, and it involves offering the consumer a concentrated product that they can pour into an empty rigid container or trigger spray through the convenient directional nozzle and then just top up with water, saving and reusing the container. Now, this one is our rethink option. And this is a massive plastic wastage crime. This is a picture inside a cupboard in my garage at home. I'm sure many of you could take a similar picture. Here's a question for all of you that recognize cartridges like this. Where do these cartridges end up when I come to use them for the second time, 6 months later? Is it A, they work perfectly and I can use the contents over and over? Or is it B, landfill? They've gone rock hard and I now need to go and buy a replacement. Well, the answer is B, unfortunately. But what if we rethink the problem? Provide multi-packs of smaller amounts, use them all if you need to, or just what you need and save the rest for next time. It's something we think would work really well in the DIY industry. Now, let's take a look at the construction of our packs. Now, I recognize we have an international audience today, so I apologize if this is UK focused, but I'm sure that you will know what the recycling requirements and capabilities are in your own countries. So depending on the product being packed and required barrier properties, we have three laminate options. The first one is a mono PE. This is the most easy to recycle, but also has the lowest of the barrier properties. It's recycle symbol 4, currently front of store. We also have a mono PP offering, still easy to be recycled, although recycled PP is generally not proof of food contact, but does have a good level of barrier properties. And that also can be recycled front of store, but is recycled symbol 5. And then we have the 4-ply laminate for products requiring a very high level of barrier properties and product resistance. We have a laminate of composite materials containing aluminium. It's recycled symbol 7. So it's currently only recycled by commercial means in the UK. However, let's not forget, whichever solution you require, they all use significantly less plastic in the first place. So the features of all our products are that they're compact, robust, lightweight, easy to carry, easy to use, with a premier appearance and feel. We have high quality and the designs are unique to Unette. Our tubes are customizable to match your brand imagery. They all have directional nozzles for control, dispense, and we have them in the range from 0.5 mil to 100 mil. One of the most common trends we're finding with our customer base at the moment is the desire to use them for online retailing. So we can put them into cartons that fit through letterboxes and they fall flat and they don't break. So ideal in those applications. So if you're a responsible brand holder and you want to reduce plastic waste by up to 80% and cost by up to 25%, you want to take a major step forward in hitting your corporate responsibility targets, and you want to bring your brand to a new generation of consumers, then contact Unette, www.unette.co.uk. And thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, David. I really enjoyed your presentation. I particularly liked Ella's video, which really brought to life how Tear and Tuck works and its benefits. So thank you. And I look forward to doing the Q&A at about 10 to the hour. So without further ado, let's look at some additional plastic packaging innovations from the PackUp's Innovation Zone platform. Smurfit Kappa Bag in Box, based in the Epernay Champagne region in France, has announced the launch of the patented VTOP Uno cap, reportedly the first cap on the bag in box market to have tamper protection attached. The new tap design complies with the upcoming single-use plastics directive, as it does not require the consumer to remove the tamper-proof cover. Instead, it is deactivated when the product is used for the first time and remains an integral part of the tap without affecting the subsequent use of the bag-in-box product. Tests on VTOP Uno in France, Spain and Sweden have shown that the convenience of the new tap remains the same and that the environmental aspect of the packaging has a positive effect on consumers' purchasing intentions. The tap is patented in Europe, the USA and several other countries. Australian sustainable packaging manufacturer Caspak has developed a new monomaterial PET top web that seals to thermoformable PET films or preformed monolayer single rigid trays. Being a monomaterial PET structure, Caspak says that this innovation makes recycling easier as consumers are able to place the entire PET tray in a curbside bin without the need to peel it away and seek out a soft plastic recycling stream as before. The top web is designed to meet APCO's minimum plastic waste weight allowance according to the Packaging Recyclability Evaluation Portal, PREP, for the hard recycling stream. The film is being offered by Caspak as an independent addition to a customer's existing mono layer trays, allowing stock on hand to be utilized to create a solution that works with existing machinery and processes. Caspak says it has plans to roll out a string of more sustainably focused packaging solutions over the coming months. Next up is a reusable solution, and we're continuing to see many refillable and reusable packaging initiatives in the innovation zone, many using plastic, as we can see here. So this is a Houston-based Drunk Elephant, what a great brand name, and they've announced that it has its two best-selling creams will be available in refillable pods. Although all the vegan and cruelty-free brands' packaging is already recyclable and comes with instructions detailing how to recycle them, Drunk Elephant's latest launch takes its eco-forward initiatives even further. The brand announced on social media that it will expand its sustainability efforts by launching refillable pods. These pods are claimed to be very easy to use. The consumer removes the cap, unscrews the pump, removes the empty inner jar, and inserts the refill pod into the outer jar. The film seal is removed, the pump is screwed back on, and a refill pot is ready. Recycling the refill pods is just as simple as getting started. Take off the cap, unscrew the pump, and from the white jar, and recycle the cap, pod, and jar. We're seeing quite a few of these recyclable and reusable pods for the cosmetics industry, and this is another good example. German noodle manufacturer Satelli has announced that it is moving its potato noodles brand out of an unrecyclable PAPE composite structure and into a recyclable PP-based material. The move was facilitated by Supac, based in Germany. The most important goal of this ambitious project was maximum product protection against food spoilage and for a long shelf life and freshness of the sensitive packaging contents. But high transparency of the packaging and the heat resistance of the film for the pasteurization of products were also close to the top of the priority list. The PP films are reported to be recyclable and reduced the pack weight by around 7%. The product is said to be the perfect combination of wheat flour, potato, egg and spices, and is often served as accompaniment to meat dishes. Cambridge Design Partnership, CDP, are a consultant offering end-to-end design and innovation services. They were approached by global beauty brand Avon, who wanted to maximize the potential of a critical new packaging launch. So this is not a new packaging innovation on shelves as such. This is a new way of testing new packaging formats. So a new Reversalist Infinite Effects Night Treatment Cream is reported to be a groundbreaking skincare product. The product combines two different night creams that need to be rotated every 7 days to prevent the user's skin adapting to the skincare regime. The solution was to use CDP's unique user insight service Dialog, that's D-I-I-A-L-O-G, for a new perspective. The Dialog service uses miniature sensing technology discreetly fitted to products or packaging to capture quantitative data during user tests. The results of the trial revealed that users were able to correctly follow the regimen of rotating the dispenser each week, while there were very few cases of trialists forgetting which end of the device to use. That's quite an interesting new way of testing new pack products, rather than relying on consumers to tell you what they're doing. You can actually get data from the packaging in this way. So that's quite an interesting new initiative. Innovia Films, based in Cumbria and mentioned many times on the Innovation Zone platform, has announced an extension to their linerless label range. Introducing a specialist matte white coated BOPP, biaxially orientated polypropylene film, called Rayoface AWP Matte. The film is available in a thickness of 92 microns and has a unique matte white printable surface on one side and an adhesive receptive coating on the other. The company says that the AWP Matte has enhanced stiffness, so it is suitable for use with all large formats, wide edge leading linerless applications from top and side C-wrap and D-wrap labels through to full wrap and skin pack labels. The enhanced coating technology means AWP Matte has a matte paper-like surface finish, but gives all the benefits that a high-performance BOPP label needs for these demanding applications. AWP Matte has reportedly got outstanding moisture and water resistance, making it perfect for labeling products such as dairy, meat or fish, which will be part of the wet or frozen supply chains. Tyson Foods Fresh Meat Division has announced the introduction of a new flow wrap pack for their case-ready ground beef products. This innovative packaging solution is quite similar to the Sainsbury's pack mentioned earlier, and uses less plastic than traditional packaging. Eliminates the need for trays. According to the company, the flow wrap requires approximately 50% less energy to produce and keeps products fresh for up to 3 times longer. So it ticks the box for sustainability as well as reducing food waste. The introduction of this pack provides retailers with an immediate solution to meet the demands of environmentally conscious consumers whilst minimizing plastic waste. A spokesperson for Tyson Foods stated that recent consumer tracking surveys have shown that consumers are willing to pay 20% more for sustainably produced fresh meat products. We often hear this, that consumers are willing to pay more for environmentally friendly packaging. I suspect with the current inflation rates being over 10%, that might not be the case presently. The flow wrap packaging offers an airtight seal to maintain the colour and freshness of the product, preventing leaks and drips, and provides a clear pack for product visibility. The packaging is also designed with a convenient tear edge for easy opening by the consumer. Initially, Tyson Foods will test the flow wrap packaging on their ground beef products from their plant in Council Bluffs, Iowa. If successful, the company will consider expanding the use of this pack to other products. Flow wrap packaging uses approximately 50% less plastic, as we saw in the Sainsbury's example, and as mentioned, 50% less energy in the manufacturing process compared to traditional expanded polystyrene equivalents. It was specifically developed to extend the freshness of meat products, as has been said. Swedish Plastic Recycling and ICA have announced the launch of a new circular plastic packaging solution made from 95% recycled plastic collected from Swedish households. The packaging will be used to pack Skåne detergent. The plastic was sorted by Swedish Plastic Recycling and turned into new plastic packaging. This collaboration represents a vision to create circular plastic flows on a large scale, reducing emissions, minimizing the need for new fossil plastics, and building a market for recycled plastic raw materials. The investment comes ahead of the expected EU legislation in 2030 that will require recycled content for all plastic packaging throughout Europe. In Sweden, the burning of plastic apparently accounts for 8% of the country's total carbon dioxide emissions. Swedish plastic recycling highlights that if we want to continue to benefit from the many positive properties of plastic, we must make it more circular, as they're trying to do here. The new Skåne bottle paves the way for plastic packaging to become part of this circular economy. As you will have seen in previous presentations, and if you are subscribed to Innovation Zone, you would have seen it on there, that by July 2024, all beverage packaging closures must be fixed or tethered to reduce their environmental impact and improve recycling. So here is another good example. So to meet this requirement, Savio Plastic AB has developed a new patented continuous snuff box with a unique design that keeps all parts of the lid, box and top lid connected even when opened. The innovative design has several positive environmental and sustainability attributes. To increase plastic recycling, it's obviously important to consider how we improve the manufacturing and design of plastic items. So Savio Plastics has a new snuff box, is injection molded entirely in one mold, which is has cost effective and environmental benefits. The streamlined design ensures that fewer parts are left in the environment and more are obviously recycled. So all the boxes, including the new continuous snuff box, are user friendly and optimized for use with filling machines. The box is delivered with the lid closed to facilitate production. Previously, Savio Plastics packaging industry customers have already been offered environmentally certified snuff box made from pine oil to reduce CO2 impact. The company has also produced and tested oyster shell cans and is currently testing various materials to create a final product that in this case will be fully compostable in ordinary household composting facilities. Overall, Savio Plastic AB is committed to developing these innovative and environmentally friendly solutions to reduce the environmental impact and to promote sustainability in the packaging industry.
David, thank you very much for your presentation. We've got quite a few questions. So first of all, I've got a couple that I would like to ask before we come on to the question we've been asked today. And I'm just really interested, how does an innovation like Tear and Tuck sort of come to market? How does something like that get created?
I think there was a period, it's actually been in existence about 12 years, this product, and our owner, Martin Hudson, collaborated with a team in the US who saw an opportunity for a reclosable sachet, and that started some time ago. But having said that, it's not really come to prominence until really the opportunity to use it as a plastic reduction solution actually came about. We had an innovation session and we looked for something which was meaningfully unique, working with those Eureka people I referred to earlier on, and gone through a series of questions asking why is it unique, why is this important? And eventually we stumbled on a point where we said, well, it's got less plastic. That's why it's unique. Yeah. And the penny dropped. And actually, it's helped to shape some of our offerings across other ranges as well.
Excellent. You mentioned in your presentation about going to Paris to go to a show. I noticed on LinkedIn that you get out and about, making sure you see what's going on, and obviously communicating the wares of Unette. What have you seen in terms of plastic packaging innovations out there? Is there
I've been out to a few shows. I'll be quite honest, I felt that the Paris show was pretty disappointing, and I felt that was largely because the priority is still clearly aesthetics over sustainability. I'm hoping I'm going to be proved wrong with that. I'm out at Cosmoprof next week, and we'll see where that's repeated over in Italy. White label, I came across a great product. I think I've seen it on your website as well, Paul. And this was a compostable bottle. So it was made from a paper pulp with a lining that made it fully compostable. That was very, very interesting. And they'd taken a stand there to promote it. You may be able to help fill people in with which one that one was.
Yeah, there's been a few in recent times. I think I know the one you're referring to. And they, I think they wrote to the NEC as well.
That's impressive. And then I think the package innovation show, the thing I liked about that one is that there's a lots of development taking place on the different laminate structures. Yeah. So although we can talk about products, it's up the line at the converters who need to do that development piece. And it's interesting, it's not necessarily just the biggest companies that are doing that, it's the most innovative companies that are actually working hard to find new ways of layers and coatings that still enable some of those products to retain the barrier properties but be recyclable as well.
Yeah. Go back to some of the questions from the audience. I think captured the imagination was the fact that you talked about understanding millennials and the younger audience. We've got a question about, has Tear and Tuck been tested on older generations that may have less sort of manual dexterity?
Well, it made us smile when that one came through. It depends what we mean by older generations. I can confirm with some surety that it's been tested on 60s pluses and 50 pluses. But it depends what we mean by older generations. I'll be quite honest, they are a little bit fiddly until you've done it once or twice, and because it's a new product, not everybody knows how it's going to work. And that's why we put Ella into the video to show how it actually works. But actually, once you've done it a couple of times, like most things, you get the knack.
Yeah. And maybe a demo video with someone a little bit older would be just as powerful because they would find it just easy.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, maybe we'll do that.
Or maybe I'm a bit older, maybe I could do it. I don't have the looks. In terms of questions that come up about recyclability, I mean, can you sort of clarify what's the sort of recyclability of the Tear and Tuck and other solutions?
So it depends on the laminates that's actually chosen. It depends on the barrier properties that the customers wanted to do. So we got a very general question there, which is great, but it all depends on shelf life that's looking to be achieved, how aggressive the product is. So we can pretty much pack anything, but it becomes less recyclable as we get the very high barrier properties. And if you need less barrier properties, then it becomes more recyclable.
Yeah, okay. Going back to this sort of a Gen Z consideration, what kind of measures did you put into place to consider to fulfill sort of Gen Z expectations who are worried about future generations?
Well, you know, one of the reasons we asked Ella to come on the video for as well, because she's from that generation. And, you know, and talking around the office, we find that, you know, it's much higher priority sustainability, the company's ethics, is much more front of mind for the younger generation in business all the time. So the choices they make are completely different. It's sort of a different thinking. We ran it through research as well, and actually having a lighter weight product, which can be used for travel, still want to travel, but lighter weight and improving on its recyclability. That was a big, big plus for that generation.
Yeah. And in fact, we had a question, or more of a sort of statement, from Ian Cooper, who's a regular viewer of our webinars, and he mentioned that a Tear and Tuck looks ideal for toothpaste to him? And you know, can you go through all the different applications again? I mean, you mentioned it in your presentation.
But yeah, nice sure. I mean, where it could be the toothpaste, I think, would work very well, particularly for a travel product, because so it's lighter as well. Fitting in those little clear bags would work. We think topical creams and following that travel theme, sun creams in particular, I think would work extremely well in the tear and tuck. We go up to 60 mil in those packs. So yeah, a nice size to take on holiday. If we went over to some of the refill packs, again, household products would fit particularly well in those, and so to go in the trigger guns. And then I do encourage everybody to have that rethink approach. You know, those cartridge guns, it just came to me how terrible it is when you're throwing that into the recycle bin. It just, you know, I refer to it as being a crime, and it certainly is. And so, you know, we've got to be talking to companies like that and say, look, let's try to think about these applications in a different way. I think everybody's going to be thinking in their own businesses about how they can find alternative out-of-the-box thinking to come up with new solutions.
Yeah. Okay, we're almost up at the hour. Can you remind people how they can get hold of you or make any contact with the company?
Sure. So our website is www.unette.co.uk, and they can there's an application form or an inquiry form on that website. And just maybe as an additional encouragement, what we'd like to do is make a donation to the Syria and Turkey Disaster Relief Fund. I was touched when we went to Packaging Innovations and unfortunately saw so many stalls. Sorry, due to unforeseen circumstances, we can't be here. It really, really brought it home on that day. I know you were presenting yourself there, Paul. So, yeah, we're going to make a £25 donation for anybody who sends an inquiry in. We'll send you the samples and we'll keep that offer open until the end of March.
Okay, excellent. Brilliant. Thank you very much, David. And I will give details of that in the email tomorrow, which will also include this full presentation recording for anyone that might want to watch it in its entirety again. So thank you very much, David. I really appreciate your time today. So thank you very much for that.
Thanks for the invitation.
Thank you. Just to confirm, our next webinar will be on biodegradable package innovations next month, and I'll have more information on that. So just goes to say thank you very much for everyone's attention today. I hope you've enjoyed the presentations and all the innovations that we're able to show you. So as I said, all the outputs will be available by tomorrow, and you'll be able to watch it in its entirety, plus get all the contact details so you can get in contact with David or me if you've got any more questions. So once again, thank you very much for your time, and see you again soon.
Thank you.